So here is an outline of what I'm planning to do in my presentation. I hope to come to the end of it within the allotted time. Let me start with a brief introduction to the to American civil religion. I'm pretty sure that many of you, or perhaps all of you in the audience, are familiar with this, but just in case you are not that into this idea, let me just quickly give you a brief grounding in it. So, there is a very definite beginning of American civil religion as a scholarly concept, because the original idea was laid out by religious sociologist Robert N. Bella in a now famous essay called Civil Religion in America, published in 1967. Bella was actually not an American studies scholar. He was a religious sociologist mostly focusing on Japanese culture and religion. So it was a kind of a holiday work for him, as he himself described it. And he was probably the most surprised to see what a splash he made with this essay, because it generated quite a big reaction, partly positive, partly negative, but a lot of interest with this concept, which gave rise to the so-called civil religion debate of the 1970s, which was, a rather cacophonic affair, I should say, because people of different disciplines, theologians, religious historians, sociologists, political scientists, all chimed in. But the debate ended pretty much without a consensus or even a dominant opinion. So people seemed to disagree pretty much about everything related to American civil religion, beginning with the very question whether such a thing exists, or is it just Bella's brainchild. Anyway, after about a decade or a decade and a half, during which civil religion generated quite a lot of scholarly interest, this began to die down in the 1980s. And I think the situation by the late 1980s is very well characterized by a contemporary essay published by a scholar, which was entitled "Whatever Happened to Civil Religion?" So it seemed that the concept pretty much went out of fashion by the late 1980s. But it did make a kind of comeback in the 2000s, probably not unrelated to, in fact, I'm pretty sure it's very close related to 9/11 and then George W. Bush's war on terror, which of course brought religious rhetoric very much into the forefront of American politics. And during the last decade or so, you can kind of observe increasing interest in civil religion, at least in terms of the number of publications in scholarly circles. But now the dominant question regarding American civil religion is whether it's still an applicable concept to American public life or political life in the increasingly radically polarized America. So this is just a brief timeline. And in order to give you a kind of a definition, let me offer the original and oft-quoted definition of Robert Bella in his original essay. He described it as a religious dimension for the whole fabric of American life, including the political sphere. This public religious dimension is expressed in a set of beliefs, symbols, and rituals that I am calling the American civil religion. So Bella basically argued that in public, especially in public utterances of politicians, but also in various rituals like celebrations of American national holidays, the monuments built for great American presidents, etc., you can observe the elements of a public religion. Actually, civil religion is also often described by other terms like common religion, a public religion, civic piety. All these terms are also in currency. But what he argued was that this is a distinct set of phenomena, which are clearly separable from organized religion on the one hand, but also from nationalism as an ideology. It's rather a kind of mixture of the two, or a blending of nationalist and religious sentiments. That's exactly what generated so much disagreement about the exact nature of American civil religion. After Bella, I would point out two other significant contributors to the civil religion debate. One of them was Martin Imarty, a famous religious scholar who wrote an essay in the 1970s in which he, pretty much following in Bella's footsteps, distinguished between two kinds of civil religion, as he called it, the priestly and the prophetic. And within that, he distinguished both a God-oriented and a nation-oriented version. This distinction is primarily interesting for us because American presidents are typically considered the main representatives of the priestly variety of civil religion. And I would also mention Roderick Hart, who was a political scientist, was, still is, I suppose. But he published a very interesting book on the so-called political pulpit, that was the title, in which he argued, as a researcher primarily of political rhetoric, that in a political context, American civil religion is not so much a full-blown religion, but rather a rhetorical phenomenon, and it should be analyzed by rhetorical criticism. And he argued that in this sense, American civil religion is more like what he called an unwritten contract between politics and organized religion about how politicians should refer to God and how they should discuss religion in their public utterances. So much in terms of a brief introduction, because of course my time is limited, and let's zero in on the presidency versus civil religion. Already Bella in his original essay cited no less than five different American presidents, ranging from George Washington to Kennedy, and even the current president at the time, Lyndon Johnson. So he based also most of his analysis on the rhetoric of various presidents, for example, Kennedy's inaugural and other similar famous speeches. Several subsequent authors afterwards specifically focused on presidential religious rhetoric and also the religious symbolism that the very institution of the presidency presents. Pierard and Linder devoted an entire book to this topic, civil religion and the presidency, in 1988. And in this book, they described the president, as you can see in the quote, as the high priest of civil faith. He leads the people in affirming and celebrating the nation, and at the same time, he glorifies the national culture and strokes his political flock. Most presidents have been a mixture of prophet, priest, preacher, and pastor, and any president can be any or all of these if he chooses. This is pretty much the way presidents are approached by scholarship when they are their civil religious role is examined. It's a very interesting question how the president's personal religion how is related to their civil religious rhetoric. We all know that all American presidents so far have declared themselves to be Christians. They have all taken their oaths of office on a Bible, but we also know that several of them were not particularly religious, in at least in the institutional sense, meaning that they didn't regularly attend church, or they didn't even belong to a specific denomination. For example, Lincoln never had a specific denomination, even though he regularly attended various churches, whereas Washington was an Episcopalian, but he rarely went to church. Eisenhower, it was already mentioned by David before, didn't actually belong to any denomination until he was persuaded by none other but Billy Graham to join the Presbyterians. But it was more or less a political decision, and not so much a religious one, that a president should belong to a denomination, at least after his election. So despite this variety of the president's personal faith, all of them spoke and employed the conventional rhetoric of American civil religion reasonably well, in a kind of routine way. And some of them are very skillfully, actually. Those are typically the presidents focused on by scholars of civil religion. In general, at least up to Donald Trump, I would say, because he has been a game changer in so many ways, including this one, presidents have been traditionally expected to play the role of a moral leader who speaks for the whole nation, who affirms American institutions and traditions, who celebrates American history and culture, with occasional critical remarks. I guess by the late 20th century, it has become kind of an unstated expectation that presidents also should make some self-critical remarks about American history, like referring to the evils of slavery, racism, religious bigotry, and such stuff. But apart from these, I would say, compulsory self-criticism, the typical role of presidents is more like the affirmation and celebration of American history, culture, and institutions. While preparing for this presentation, I've come across a very interesting 2019 study by scholar Kerry Hughes, who examined — this is actually something many people have done before him, but his research expanded to the largest textual body of evidence of all. He examined the religious rhetoric of all presidents from Franklin D. Roosevelt to Trump, and by means of a computer analysis. So it was actually not done by reading everything, but rather running an enormous body of text through a computer-based analysis. And he found that the frequency of religious words and explicit references to God significantly increased since the 1980s, beginning with Ronald Reagan's presidency. This actually confirms what many previous scholars have argued and found without statistical analysis, namely that Ronald Reagan brought an entirely new style of religious rhetoric in fashion. He was speaking a lot more often and a lot more openly about not just, you know, a generalized God, but about the Bible, Christ, salvation, etc. So those elements that didn't used to be the part of civil religion, but rather people's private religion. The second finding of this essay was that Republican presidents have consistently applied religious language more frequently than Democrats, even though the difference is not that big, as one would perhaps surmise, based on the generalized image that the majority of conservative religious voters tend to vote Republican, whereas the majority of non-religious people tend to vote Democrat. If you look at the actual figures of his research, you find that while some Republican presidents have indeed been outstanding in this respect, the differences are significant but not huge. But what really surprised me in this essay is the following. He has found that Donald Trump has employed more God talk than any other president in the past 90 years, including George W. Bush and Ronald Reagan. In fact, by far more religious words and references to God than any other president. For illustration, let me show you the actual chart presented by him. This is, as you see, the figures are words per 1,000 dedicated to religious terms or to God in not just major speeches, but also various. So not he didn't just look at, State of the Union addresses and inaugural speeches, as many other scholars did, but also minor policy speeches as well. I'm not sure to what extent this is reliable, but if it is, then it means that Donald Trump has indeed undergone a remarkable transformation during the 4 years of his office in his rhetoric, because I'm pretty sure that during the campaign for the presidency in 2016, he was not the most religious speaking candidate in the Republican fold or in the Republican primary campaign. And now let's zero in on Donald Trump, who is the actual focus, or supposed to be the actual focus of today's presentation. What I call the Trump conundrum is something pretty obvious to anybody who has been following the history of American presidency for some time. Presidential scholars have some common wisdoms about who can be elected to the presidency in America. I've been teaching classes on American government for some time now. And of course, I kept telling my students pretty much the same stuff, that there are certain unwritten rules that you must keep if you want to become president of America. Now, Donald Trump has shattered many of these unwritten rules. For instance, that you must be, you must have some political experience, some political career before you run for president, unless you are, of course, a successful military general, because that was the other path to the White House. As you know, General Grant or General Eisenhower was elected without any previous political career. But other than military heroes, all previous presidents came from the political class until Donald Trump. The second unwritten rule was that you gotta be married and you gotta have a more or less exemplary private life. Now, that's another rule that didn't apply to Donald Trump. He was the first twice divorced president in American history with a previous private life that was often on the pages of tabloid news, etc. So you would have been reasonable to think that, especially in a conservative party like the Republican Party, that would be a disqualifying factor. It wasn't, as we all know. And I think most shocking of all is that Donald Trump, during his campaign and during his presidency, broke all the established rules of political communication whenever he made one offensive or scandalous or outrageous remark after another, which usually in the past have sunk political candidates pretty quickly. And these only made him more popular rather than less. So I think this is what his opponents kept waiting for, a scandal that would ultimately scuttle Donald Trump. And instead, he just kept going on and kept winning primaries until he became the candidate of the Republican Party. And then, of course, at a very, very narrow election, probably with a lot of luck, he also became president of the US. Now, out of all these, I think the most interesting is that Donald Trump was arguably the president with the weakest religious background for a century. I would say since William Taft, who was sometimes accused of being an atheist. And I think the most questionable presidential candidate ever. And yet, as we all know, he received about 80% of the conservative evangelical vote in 2016. And after 4 years in power, he basically repeated this achievement, which means that he got a higher percentage of the evangelical vote than George W. Bush or Ronald Reagan, the two previous conservative heroes of the religious right. How is that possible? Now, I'm not giving you an answer here, don't get me wrong, because this is probably something that a host of political scholars are trying to explain for some time. But I would just raise the parallel, and I don't want to scandalize anybody if I make a parallel between Donald Trump and Ronald Reagan. I know the two characters are not very similar. I'm fully aware of that fact. But it is an interesting parallel to my mind that back in 1980, Ronald Reagan was running against a very religious, born-again Christian, of course, the sitting president, Jimmy Carter, and yet he managed to get the majority of white evangelicals behind him. Something comparable happened, I think, in 2016, even though Donald Trump was, of course, running against a person very strongly disliked by the religious right. That was, of course, Hillary Clinton. So I probably he had a much easier job of winning over the religious right. But you can certainly observe that after that happened, Donald Trump slowly but steadily began to advertise his religion, so to say. So, first of all, he began to publish pictures like pictures of his Presbyterian confirmation in 1959. Oh, by the way, that might fit your research, Meredith, now that I just realized. he began, of course, to emphasize a more conservative position on issues close to the heart of evangelicals. There is a list of examples on the slide. But most importantly, he began to change his language. And for example, in the State of the Union, the last State of the Union address he gave in 2020, he carefully included such passages as the one I'm quoting here. My administration is also defending religious liberty, and that includes the constitutional right to pray in public schools. In America, we don't punish prayer. We don't tear down crosses. We don't ban symbols of faith. We don't muzzle preachers and pastors. In America, we celebrate faith. We cherish religion. We lift our voices in prayer, and we raise our sights to the glory of God. So this is the kind of God talk that probably featured high in that statistical count that I showed you earlier. Here are two illustrations of what I'm talking about, the 2017 photo op in the White House with various evangelical faith leaders, and of course, the very controversial picture with the Bible outside St. John's Church in March 2020. You know, it was controversial primarily because demonstrators were tear gassed and cleared from the area so that Trump could pose with the Bible here. I think on the whole, we can say that Trump was not very convincing with this religious rhetoric on the whole, because this is a survey from Pew Research Center made in early 2020, in which they asked how religious is President Donald Trump. And as you can see, almost two-thirds of the American public, at least, I mean, the respondents, of course, this is just a survey, answered not at all or not too much. The only groups that that produced the majority in favor of Trump's religiousness were white evangelicals and Republican-leaning voters. Probably there was a lot of overlap between these two groups. But even among them, only 12% said that Donald Trump would be very religious. So I think we can agree that most of the public didn't buy this rhetoric of Donald Trump, but nonetheless, the alliance between Donald Trump and the white evangelicals seems to have worked out well nonetheless. But so far I've been talking about Trump's religious rhetoric, and I would like to close my presentation on a slightly different discussion, because I think Trump's religious rhetoric is not the primary measure of how successful he was or how unsuccessful he was as a leader of, or high priest, to quote Pierre Arden Linder, in American civil religion. I think that as a moral leader of the nation, or at least to practice the rhetoric of American civil religion, Trump had some successes because his nationalist rhetoric and slogans, things like America First, Make America Great Again, etc., were very much in line with the nation-oriented version of American civil religion. So that kind of proud nationalist and individualist tradition of American civil religion, which always emphasized basically the key notions of American exceptionalism, that America is a special nation in the world. America has a mission, a divine mission to fulfill in the world. America's best, greatest, most successful, everything is possible, etc. If you look at, for example, the scripted State of the Union addresses, which were obviously written by others and not by Trump, there this rhetoric dominates absolutely. I don't want to read out this quote, but you can see that this is, I mean, I could cite a dozen passages like this from any State of the Union address where he emphasizes the American people, American flag, American way, American faith, American family, whatever American essentially is great. And of course, it's nicely woven together here with the idea that faith and family and in God we trust are the real American values. So in that respect, we can say that Trump was to some extent continuing the tradition of American civil religion in his rhetoric. On the other hand, where he spectacularly failed as a leader of civil religion is obviously pretty much everything else he did as a president. First of all, American presidents have always been expected and always aspired to be leaders of the whole nation, not just their own party or their own supporters. And Donald Trump, as we all know, was spectacularly unsuccessful in this respect. In fact, I would argue that he at times seemed to not really care for this role at all. So I think he gave a whole new definition to the idea of the bully pulpit. But, you know, this is a term often associated with presidents as chief rhetoricians or rhetoricians in chief, that this the term originates from Theodore Roosevelt, who originally said that he has a bully pulpit when because of course he cannot force Congress to do anything, but he can always go public and make speeches and so bully people into doing things he would like them to do. Now, I think in case of Trump, this bully pulpit was more his Twitter account, but there he acted pretty much as a traditional school bully and a very ugly one at that, because of course his infantized narcissism always broke through in terms of taking offense at anything, any kind of criticism, but also really getting back at his perceived critics and opponents in a very aggressive and childish way. And also in the process, completely forgetting that he is not a private person anymore, but he is the president of the United States. I think one of the most distasteful examples of this was when he made a disparaging remark about John McCain to the effect that he prefers people who didn't, who weren't captured in a war. Of course, we all know that John McCain was a military hero of the Vietnam War, and both parties across the aisle respected him tremendously for his war record. So when Trump made remarks like these, he essentially jeopardized his role as the moral leader of the nation. But I think the fitting conclusion of his presidency was obviously the last stage, when he, for the first time in American history, he refused to concede an election he lost, and he continued to agitate against the acceptance of the results of the election, calling it countless times as the Big Steal, which of course led to the unprecedented assault on the Capitol on January 6, 2021. here are two quotes. I'm not going to read them out because my time is almost up, but these are just two quotes from that speech, which I think go absolutely, or went absolutely contrary to anything that American civil religion is about in terms of respecting American political institutions and American tradition, and especially that often used and cherished value of American history, the peaceful transfer of power. So in that respect, I think Donald Trump did lasting damage to American civil religion. But at the same time, I'm afraid that this lasting damage is going to continue, because now it seems that American civil religion is split into essentially two kinds of civil religion, two kinds of groups who both believe that they are the true patriots of the country and the true supporters of American constitutional values and tradition. And this is exactly the opposite of what American civil religion is supposed to be originally about. Thank you very much for your kind attention.